Hey everyone, today putting a aftermarket radio in my 2001 GMC Sierra. This should be the same steps for pretty much any 99, I think all the way actually up to the 07 classic body style. I could be wrong. For pretty much GMC, Sierra, Chevy Silverado, you know, maybe even the Yukons. Pretty much if your dash looks like this, it's all going to be the same steps for you. So I originally wanted to go with a double DIN setup. However, I found out that the factory trim panel is not big enough to accommodate a double DIN. I wanted like a touch screen that could do DVD, CD, all that. You could kind of just cut this out more, but you'd still need to buy the mounting brackets. And then the filler panel for a double DIN is actually this whole trim piece that goes around. That is Metra part number DP-3002B, if you do want to do that. Best Buy wanted like $200 for that filler panel, and the cheapest I found it online was $130. So combined with the cheapest double DIN touchscreen that I found, would have been $300-$400. And honestly, this, you know, I got this truck, it's my daily. I got it for $1,500. It's not worth putting a lot of money into, so I'm just gonna stick with a normal radio for now. They don't have the normal Sony I normally throw in, so I got a little bit different one this time. I'm gonna go through all the different things you need here. Now, I think they gave me a different brand of harness than I normally get. Usually all the filler panel, the antenna adapter, the harness, everything is Metra brand, because that's just what Best Buy carries, and that's where I usually get my stuff since I have a Best Buy credit card. So ignore this number. I don't know who makes this one, but as far as the Metra brand goes, if you have a truck like this one where there's no factory amplifier or anything, no premium sound system, your part number is going to be 70-1858, and that again is Metra brand. Same thing for if you have the amplified version with the premium sound, Metra brand again, and that will be 70-1859. Regardless of what setup you have, your antenna adapter is going to be this 40-GM10. And again, I already told you the filler panel for the double DIN setup. This is the 99-3002. And it says for 95 to 02. So if you have something newer than an 02, you might want to check it. I mean, I could have swore the 03 dashes were the same, but they might have changed something small. So you might want to do some research on which filler panel you need if you have an 03 or newer. The radio we're putting in is this Sony MEX N5100BT. It's got USB and auxiliary. The ports are actually on the back, I guess, on this one, so I'll be routing some cables out through the dash. So let's get started. First step is going to be to pull this trim piece. You can try to use something like a screwdriver, a flathead, to stick down here and gently pry out, or maybe just grab and pull. So we're gonna work on that right now. All right, so the easiest way to do this without tools that I found was I just grabbed this corner. That was the weakest corner. I grabbed it with both hands and just kind of pulled. And then you can kind of work your way around, gently pulling, making sure you're not breaking anything. You want to snap your dash panel, or you'll be buying that expensive one. Let's finagle that out of there now. We might have to use the steering wheel tilt, or sometimes turn the key on and move the shifter up or down to get the panel off, just because it might hit this. But if you do put this in drive or reverse or neutral or something, make sure you got your foot on the brake so your truck don't go rolling away on you. And as soon as you get the panel off, make sure to throw it back up in park. Yeah, I did have to put the shifter down, by the way. And I actually am going to have to move the steering wheel down just a tad, because it has this bezel for the cluster built into it as well, so it takes up quite a bit of space. Throw that in the back seat. Alright, like I said, back into park, turn the key off. I want to roll away. Next will be to remove the factory radio. All right, now your first step should actually be to disconnect the batteries. If you've got a 2500 or a 3500, you probably have two batteries. One would be over there, one over here. This is a half ton, so we only have one. Positive's got a little protector on it. Just pull back on that to pop it off. It's a 5/16 or an 8mm socket to get these off. Usually disconnect the ground, then the positive. And then when I reconnect it, I put the positive on, then the ground is, I believe, the proper procedure for that. All right, now it looks like it's actually pretty easy to remove the factory radio. You don't even really need any tools. I don't know if you can see this, but there's this little plastic finger right here. Let's see if we can focus a little better. Right here. Just push down on that. You'll feel it push down. And then there's one over here as well. Right there, push down on that, and you got to hold down on both of them and pull pretty firmly. Obviously my dash is, or my radio is factory, so she's been in there a while. I had to give it a good jerk, but it just pulls right on out after that. Might have to move the shifter again. So there's that. Now we're gonna go ahead and unplug our harnesses. All right, now the radio antenna pulled straight out. This plug, I'm not even sure what it's for, because as far as I'm concerned, I don't have any premium sound or anything, so I don't even know why this one has two plugs. But this one was just pinch and pull. Same with this one, the main harness, pinch and pull. So it looks like we got the right one. We're just gonna match up the new harness real quick, plug it in, just make sure it's gonna work, and then plug this radio antenna adapter in as well. As you can see, the antenna adapter is necessary. It's kind of hard to tell maybe in here, but the adapter is definitely bigger, so it is needed. All right, we've got that pushed on as far as it'll go. Made sure it's got good contact. And by the way, if you do have the premium sound system or you have steering wheel mounted controls, I'll put a little card up here that'll pop up linking you to a thing called a, I forget who makes it, but I think the part number is like ASWC-1. I think it's made by Access or something. It's a steering wheel adapter module, so you can tap in and retain your factory steering wheel controls. I put that in my 2004 Jeep Grand Cherokee Limited, and it worked out great. So we're gonna continue now, make sure this fits, and wire that in. All right, so as you can see, the adapter plugged in well, it works, it's proper. Now, instead of getting the new Sony harness out and wiring it all out while it's plugged in, I'm actually going to unhook this and go inside and do it at the table because it'll be a little bit easier. I'm going to use what I always use. There's multiple different methods to do this. I use heat shrink butt connectors just because it's easier and safer to do than soldering. Although, you know, pick your preference. Soldering is technically the best way to go. It's going to give you the best connection, but you're going to want some sort of like shrink tubing to slide over the solders when you're done or something to protect the wires from touching each other. Same with, you don't want to just twist these together and shove it back in your dash because everything's going to touch each other and short out. So I really recommend something like this where you just strip the wires back. Like these are already pre-stripped. So all you got to do is slide the butt connector on there. You got my fancy schmancy little stripper and crimper here, crimp it down, good to go. You can heat shrink it if you want with a lighter or a heat gun, and that actually shrinks down and clamps on the wiring insulation, keeps it from pulling out as easily, and keeps moisture in that out. Now, I'm kind of a noob as far as this whole Bluetooth and audio thing. I've never had a microphone in my vehicle before, but it came with one, so I'm gonna try it. I don't know if it'll work or not. Basically, I went a little bit further and I pulled this panel back a little bit, and you can see down here there's a tab as well as up here, and down here they're held in by like these little metal clips you just pull. So I'm gonna feed, I already did actually, I fed the antenna down between the pillar here, and then I'm gonna stuff the extra wire up behind here, and I'm gonna fish it through. It's kind of hard to see, but there is a gap. You can pull this forward here where the four-wheel drive switch goes, pull it forward, and I'm gonna fish it through here and run it along the back of my cluster to the radio. Here's a better shot now that I got this all the way out. There actually ended up being a fourth tab right here in the upper left corner. And I was able to get the mic cord fed through. Make sure you don't have the wire going across your air duct piping, because then you're gonna pinch it. All right, there you go. It's fairly neat for what it is. I got it tucked up there, got it nice and tucked behind the pillar, ran down through there, can't even see it. Got it coming in just above the air ducting so it doesn't get pinched. And I ran it above and behind the instrument cluster, up and over this bracket, and back here. So I didn't really have to pull a lot to do it. Now we're gonna put this back together. All right, got those four clips snapped back in. Now we're gonna push the four-wheel drive shifter back in after making sure everything's still good. That, and then I'm gonna put my clip back on here that popped off, slide that on here, and just push the knee bolster panel back up. All right, so we got the fuse cover panel snap back on, got this snap back up into place. I actually made a mistake earlier. When you pull this down, I should have known something was up, because I pulled this off and it was really hard to pull it. There's actually a little bolt down here. You want to undo that. It's a 9/32 socket or wrench, and that will make it a lot easier to pull this off and get it back into place, because without that screw pulled, I was fighting this thing and was not able to get it back into place. And then one more quick little tidbit here, that dash panel I was talking about that we removed back there, if you're doing the double din, I've only seen those come in black. So if you have tan interior, that might be something to think about. I mean, I don't think it would look horrible, but just know that it won't match. You can paint it. There might be other manufacturers that make the tan one, but the Metro one comes black. All right, now that I'm done with my rant and my little tangent that we went off on here, we're gonna go back to our primary goal here to get the harness wired in. Now this is pretty self-explanatory. You just go color to color, you know, black to black, green to green. You gotta be careful though, because some of the greens have stripes on them. Some, you know, all the colors have stripes on them. Basically the speakers, each speaker set has a normal color and then one with a stripe on it. So you just wanna make sure you're going stripe to stripe, color to color on here, one at a time, so you don't get them all mixed up. We're gonna do that. All right, as you can see, I've gone color to color. The only real exception here is there's an orange with a white stripe that I put to solid orange because there is no other orange. And then this blue one, there's a blue one coming out of the Metro connector and a blue with a white stripe on it coming out of the radio. This is actually your signal wire that would run to your amp if you had less, you know, subs in your vehicle. I connected blue to blue just for shits and giggles. If you had a power wire for your amp to tap into, you would twist two of the wires together and cram them in one end, so you'd actually have three wires total connected together here. So as you can see, I've got the heat shrinks, all of them done except for one, so I can show you how it works. Like I said, you can use a heat gun, a lighter, a micro torch like this. You just don't want to get too close to it. I'll stay a little bit away, and you can see it kind of start to shrink. Go around it evenly, and yeah, I burnt the wire a little bit. Try not to do that. Like I said, you can do this with a cigarette lighter or something. Just doesn't go as fast, and you can see it like oozed out a little bit right there. That means that it's shrunk all the way, and you know, no junk is gonna get in there, no corrosion or anything, and it also keeps the wires from getting pulled apart. So now we're ready to
plug this in to the truck and the radio.
Boss. Anyway, back to it. All right, so the filler panel came with this little trim piece in there, and you can see there's actually a little catch down here for it. I test fitted my radio, and it looks like I need to keep this in there for a tighter fit. So I'm gonna go ahead, put the radio in here. I had to put the faceplate on so I know which direction to go, because I was too dumb to figure it out without it. So I've got my panel the right direction. This is how it's gonna slide in, with like the little finger tab on the bottom. It's actually gonna slide right in these two grooves here. So that means the radio has to go this way. Look at that, nice fit. Now is the tricky part though. Kind of a pain to get at on this one. You wanna take and bend some of these metal tabs up so that the radio can't slide back out. So I'm gonna get a flathead screwdriver and do that now. All right, so as you can see, I've got the tab slightly bent up. I just stuck a little flathead in there, pushed up on it. From there, you can either use your fingers or some sort of needle nose or side cutter like this and just bend it over all the way to make sure that it's pushed, keeping constant pressure on this nice and tight, so it's not gonna rattle in your dash. See, you don't want that going on. So this has to be peeled all the way back. So I got done bending that one over, and it actually wasn't tight enough to satisfy me, so I went ahead and did the next one over. I wasn't able to get a complete bend out of it, but enough to where it'll grab and there's no play there now. So now I just have to do the other three corners, one right here and then two on that side. There we have it, all four bent over, snug as a bug in a rug. Now we're gonna go ahead and plug everything into the back of the radio here. Make sure not to let it just dangle by the harness there, because you can rip wires and pins out. All right, when I plugged it in, I heard it do a little thing, so sounds like we got it right. I just went ahead and kind of tucked everything back there for now. I'm gonna put this in. Oop. Just like that. I'm not gonna push it in quite all the way yet. I guess it don't matter, it's easy to pull out. Now don't force it. If it's not gonna go in all the way, pull it back out and move some of the wires around. You're probably pinching it in the back of the dash. So I'm gonna have to pull this back out and reorganize a little bit. There we go. Two clicks. And let's see what we got. Look at that.
Some people will.
Boop, 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 boop.
Selection. How big's your showroom, Dan?
Well, it has 35 boats in.
Now I'll have to look into how to use the actual Bluetooth, because like I said, I'm kind of a Bluetooth noob. All right, so I'll go through the menu here. You can kind of skip forward if you don't have this style radio to where the dash goes back together, or I'm sure you can figure out how to do it yourself by now. But this button here to switch between settings, we got our radio, CD, USB, which is actually hidden. This slides over, it's kind of cool. We got our aux, Bluetooth, Pandora, phone, and Sirius. Try this quick. Ah, oh, yeah, much better. Couldn't stand listening to the same three radio stations anymore. All right, enough of my babbling. I'm gonna unplug all this, start putting the dash back together. So the dash goes back together the same way it came apart. Put the shifter down, make sure you got your foot on the brakes, you don't roll away. Obviously gotta have the key on for that. Tilted the wheel down. And then I stuffed the bottom section of the panel down behind the steering column first, and then now I'm gonna just shove down on this and push forward and snap it all into place. Make sure you're lining up all of the little guide pins and snap clips with their proper holes, so you're not forcing anything. If you try to snap it in when it's not lined up, you can snap something or break it, so just keep an eye on that. And just like that, we're done. If you have this radio, stay tuned. I'll show you kind of how to take it out of demo mode, change the colors, audio settings, things of that nature. All right, so now we're gonna go through the operations of this radio. If you happen to get the same one, most Sonys will be maybe not exactly the same steps, but pretty close. First off, you have a mega bass button here. All that does is make more bass, obviously. When you get this, and remember this is the little slider here to access your USB, covers it up. When you get this, it's gonna be in demo mode and it's gonna have the beep turned on. So, get back here. To turn that stuff off, you're gonna wanna go to menu. The older Sonys, I believe you just push this button in. This one, you gotta go to menu. Let's see here. Maybe the beep is under sound, I can't remember. Nope. To go back, you just hit this button right here, the little back arrow. Go in and hit display. You can pick your colors, what color you want the menu to be. There's demo mode. Click into that, turn that off so it's not flashing all over. You can turn the dimmer on auto or off. See if you can tell here. Dims a little bit when I turn the headlights on. All right. What else we got? I got the beep. Where's the beep? Turn that off. Sound? Oh, we were just in there. General. There it is. Off. You can set your clock, which I already have mine set. Got my color set. One of the things I noticed is when you put it on, say, your iPod, when you turn it on and you try to play a song, the radio takes control. I have no control on my iPod right now. So you have to use this to go through all your tracks and stuff. If you don't want that, what you do is you hold the back button. And now I have control on the iPod again. To do radio presets, it's pretty much the same as any other radio. You just pick the station you want and hold the preset you want. And it'll have a little asterisk next to it with the number that you picked. So that's all set. That's pretty much it. You can go in to sound and you can mess with your sub if you have that. Bass, there's presets, otherwise you can go in and you can do custom setup, adjust your fade, your balance, all that happy jazz. Now I'm going to show you how to use the Bluetooth. Okay, now it shows how to do all this on page 15, I think, or sorry, 8 of your instruction manual, but I'll just show you anyway. So basically you turn your Bluetooth on your phone or whatever device you're using, and then you'll push this call button here, and if it doesn't go to set pairing automatically, you'll want to go over to it, but this one does, so we'll just go to set pairing, hit the middle button, and then your phone should detect the device, which it'll be called MEX-N5100BT. And you'll click on that, and that's pretty much it. My phone popped up saying that I needed something downloaded from the App Store, but I just exited out of that, and I actually called my own phone number for my voicemail, and it did play through the speakers on the truck, so I don't know why it asked for that, but, and then you'll see there should be all of these icons lit up once your phone has detected that it's connected, so I'm gonna do that now. There you go. It's paired. You can see all the icons there. It shows your cell strength signal, your Bluetooth and all that. It says Tony's iPhone. Now, according to the instruction manuals, I haven't tried this yet because I don't have somebody here to call me right now, but it says if you get an incoming call, you press the call button to answer it, and to reject the call, you press and hold the off button for 1 second, and to end a call, you hit call again. I'm assuming when they say the off button, they mean this SRC button, because I believe if you get close enough, it says off. To make a call, I haven't tried going through my phone yet, but you can go through here as well, hit the call button. If it doesn't go to phone book automatically, just roll over to it. There's also redial, voice dial, blah, blah. So we go to phone book. I think you can talk when it says listening there, and maybe it'll dial for you. Otherwise, you roll through and pick the letter, and then you can scroll through all of your contacts under that letter. I just tried a phone call, called my mom. It worked fine. Had to turn the speakers up to about 35 to hear clearly, about 10 levels higher than you would listen to music. And as with most of these cheaper Bluetooth speakers, or sorry, microphones, obviously you're a couple feet away from it, so you kind of have to shout into it. You got to be a little bit louder with it. The receiver on the other end, they can hear you, but it's kind of quiet, so just a forewarning, you should probably speak up. And by the way, I use the USB cord instead of the aux cord, not only because it charges the iPod, but it also turns the iPod on and off with the ignition, so that's nice. That pretty much wraps up this install. I hope this helped you guys out. Like and subscribe for more.